Oh, good afternoon and welcome. Thank you so much for joining today's Alliance for Health Policy briefing, What's Next on Mental Health, Making the System Work for People Living with Schizophrenia. I'm Sarah Dash, President and CEO at the Alliance for Health Policy. We are a nonpartisan resource for the policy community dedicated to advancing knowledge and understanding of health policy issues. I want to offer a special welcome today to those who are joining us for the first time, and particularly to those who are joining us who are either living with a schizophrenia diagnosis or who are loved ones or family members or community members. It is really so important for you all to be in this virtual room today, along with those in the policy, clinical, and scientific communities from coast to coast who are listening in today and working every day to make a difference. So welcome. Today's briefing is brought to you in partnership with the Schizophrenia and Psychosis Action Alliance and generously supported by Karuna Therapeutics, Sunovion, and you can go to the next slide, please, Boehringer Ingelheim, Otsuka America Pharmaceuticals, Teva Pharmaceuticals, Acadia Pharmaceuticals, and Neurocrine Biosciences. If you could go to the next slide so we could thank all our wonderful supporters. Thank you so much for that. You can follow, if you go to the next slide, the Alliance for Policy on the Alliance for Health Policy on LinkedIn to stay informed about upcoming events. You can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter. So, next slide, please. Today's panel has a Q&A section at the end. We want you all to be active participants. So please feel free to send questions in at any time. To do so, you should see a dashboard on the right side of your web browser. It has a little speech bubble icon with a question mark, and you can go ahead and use that to submit questions that you have for the panelists at any time. We'll collect them and address them during the Q&A portion of the webinar. You can also send a chat in case you have any technical issues, and someone will do our best to help. So, with that being said, you can move to the next slide. Thanks. So great. So I am so pleased today that we are holding this webinar on what is known as World Schizophrenia Day, and it's part of our series on What's Next in Mental Health, which builds on a year-long effort that the Alliance held in 2022 on mental health in America, and certainly a lot of bipartisan activity in this space. So with that being said, I'm so pleased to introduce Dr. Arundhati Nagrindra, or otherwise known as Arun, from the Schizophrenia and Psychosis Action Alliance for some opening remarks. She is the Director of Research and Scientific Affairs at SNPAA. Prior to that role, she completed her doctorate in clinical psychology at UNC Chapel Hill, as well as a clinical internship at the Yale School of Medicine and a postdoctoral fellowship at Harvard Medical School. She is passionate about improving access to evidence-based care for individuals who have experienced psychosis as well as their family members, and has spearheaded research in this area for over a decade. So we're so thrilled that Arun is joining us to give some opening remarks. And then she will introduce Polly Benjamin, who is joining us today to share their lived experience as a person who is who has had several diagnoses. And we feel at the Alliance that it is so important to bring, again, those real authentic voices of people who are having those experiences to you in the policy community. So we're really grateful to Polly for joining us as well. So Arun, why don't you come on camera and make some opening remarks? Thanks.
All right. Thank you for that introduction, Sarah. So hi, everyone. As Sarah said, my name is Arun, and I'm the Director of Research and Scientific Affairs for the Schizophrenia and Psychosis Action Alliance. I'm honored today to introduce this webinar about making our systems of care work for people who have schizophrenia or experience psychosis. For those who are less familiar with schizophrenia, it is a treatable, no-fault brain illness that affects about one in every 100 people worldwide, so it's quite common. The hallmark of schizophrenia is what we call psychosis, which comprises three symptoms: hallucinations, delusions, and disorganized thoughts and behaviors. Hallucinations are sensory experiences in the absence of sensory input. They are most commonly auditory, consisting of voices talking or even yelling, and can also be visual, seeing shapes and people who are not there. But actually, hallucinations can happen in any modality, smelling rotten fish, tasting blood, or feeling like your body is covered in spiders. Delusions refer to beliefs that do not have any factual support, and they're most often persecutory, so having thoughts that other people or entities plan to harm you. The content of hallucinations and delusions are often metaphorical and reflect themes of feeling unsafe, unloved, and inadequate. Feelings I think we can all relate to that manifest in an especially painful way for those experiencing psychosis. Beyond hallucinations and delusions, psychosis also consists of disorganized thoughts and behaviors, which emerge in various forms, but explain why, for example, you might sometimes see people out on the street dressed in thick winter clothes in the middle of summer when it's 95 degrees out. Other symptoms of schizophrenia involve difficulties with socializing, expressing and reading emotions, and cognition. So what causes schizophrenia? Well, studies of genetics and neuroscience have clearly demonstrated that schizophrenia is a brain disease. In identical twins, if one person has schizophrenia, the other twin has a 50% likelihood of also having the illness. This is one of the highest genetic loadings of any known mental illness. Schizophrenia often manifests during the late teens and early 20s and can be triggered by environmental stressors like the stress of going away to college and leaving home for the first time. This is one of the tragedies of schizophrenia. It hits during a crucial developmental period, derailing college and job aspirations, friendships, romantic relationships, and family dynamics, and it leads to high rates of isolation and loneliness. Schizophrenia is a long-term condition, but it is treatable and manageable, especially with early intervention. The gold standard of treatment involves an integrated treatment team consisting of a psychiatrist trained in high-quality medication management, individual therapy that promotes autonomy, self-determination, and resilience, caregiver therapy and support, and employment and education services. When these are all in place, people with schizophrenia have a much higher likelihood of leading meaningful and productive lives. But it is a simple fact that most people with schizophrenia receive inadequate care or no care. Our healthcare system is not equipped to treat those with the illness. For example, a recent national study showed that the need for psychiatric beds in hospitals exceeds the actual capacity by 44%. In general, finding a psychiatrist is almost impossible, especially in rural communities, let alone the gold standard of a multifaceted treatment team. As such, the long-term picture of schizophrenia is bleak. Over 75% of those with schizophrenia stop taking antipsychotic medications, the first line of treatment, within 2 years, often because of horrible side effects like massive weight gain, heart disease, and diabetes. As such, there is a need for better medications, and we celebrate our pharmaceutical supporters who are working to develop these new treatments. In addition, rather than getting integrated psychiatric care, people with schizophrenia comprise a third of the homeless population in the US and at least 20% of the prison population. They cycle through institutions repeatedly, homeless shelters, the streets, prisons, jails, and hospitals, just unable to find stable footing. People with schizophrenia die approximately 20 years earlier than those without the illness. Some of this is because of the extremely high rates of completed suicide associated with this illness, about 10%. But this decreased life expectancy is actually mostly because of preventable causes like heart disease and substance use. But things do not have to be this way. We can do better. Most people with schizophrenia, research has shown, want to connect to and contribute to their communities. They report that loneliness is the second most important challenge in their lives, second only to financial concerns. Although less than 10% of people with schizophrenia have consistent paid employment, most of them actually report that they want to work. People with schizophrenia deserve to thrive, fall in love, find meaningful employment, drive a car, and maintain their physical health. They have so much to contribute to our communities. And as lawmakers and advocates, we have a responsibility to change systems so that people with schizophrenia can reach their potential. Our goal with this webinar is for attendees to understand some key systematic barriers to care for people with schizophrenia, as well as the steps that we need to take to improve the current state of affairs. Each of our wonderful speakers will describe a different part of the system and highlight how systemic change could make the difference that we so desperately need to see. We will end with 30 minutes of moderated discussion and welcome and encourage you all to share your thoughts and questions with us. Thank you all for attending this webinar. I am hopeful that this will be one step towards providing those with schizophrenia the quality of care that they need and deserve. And with that, I will start with a fireside chat with Polly. Polly, do you want to turn on your camera?
Yep, we're going on right now. There we go.
All right. Hi, Polly. So by way of introduction, Polly is a self-employed tarot reader, wordsmith, tech artist, and hybrid inventor, and they enjoy liminal story crafting, especially with music. They've also had over 30 years of experience navigating mental health care systems in the US. Polly uses plural pronouns such as they, we, and us. All right, Polly, so, you know, as is commonly the case, we've talked about how your symptoms first started when you went to college. Could you tell us a little bit about that time?
Yes, and thank you, Dr. Arun. Before we answer, we'd like people to know that with many things that we say, our intent is always to minimize blame, guessing, and assumptions, and that sometimes when we say the word you, we mean someone. So in the year 1990, we were 17, we moved out of our parents' home for the first time to move into the dorms at Western Michigan University and start our freshman year. I was in a very new environment where we were able to be ourselves and were so happy socializing in many new and exciting ways, of course. And like many people's first college experiences, that included using like alcohol a lot more. And so our grades started to slip. As an almost straight A student up to that point, that was something we were unfamiliar with and we thought we could recover on our own at any time. But since the grades continued to not improve, that slowly ate away at our self-esteem. And from that, we in turn started to become more depressed and anxious. So although this was not something we'd experienced before, we didn't really truly realize what was happening, even though it felt very real to us. So then by our sophomore year in 91, we felt very lonely despite having a lot of good friends around us. They wanted to help us, but they didn't really know how. I mean, the public discourse was even less than it is today. And so we were not able to express what we really needed or even what we were going through. So even though we were surrounded by a lot of other people, I felt very alone. We eventually stopped attending classes altogether, which worsened the anxiety and the depression. That led to our psychotic symptoms for the first time. So for example, I began to experience paranoia. Like, did that person just wink at me? Why do I even know them? Hallucinations, most of mine have always been audible. Was that a whisper, someone talking to me? I'd even ask the person, no, I didn't whisper. And then those eventually morphed into much more pronounced paranoia, especially among some other things. One particular time I was at a friend's house, many people were there. There was a party going on downstairs. A bunch of us run down the stairs making a lot of noise. I turn and look at the busy room and it's, you know, everyone's looking at us, of course, because we were making noise, but I'm like, why is everyone looking at me? And then I just ran out of the door. That was extremely traumatic for me. So as these symptoms worsened, we knew we were behaving in ways that were possibly odd. Some of our friends were okay with that, but often we were very uncomfortable or we even felt bullied sometimes. So we would cry, we would stumble or shake, mispronounce and slur our words. We'd feel nervous and tense from too much noise in the room. And that didn't seem to bother anyone else. So we knew we were not like acting normal, but we didn't want to be hospitalized if we did that too much. We would try to act normal because the stigma surrounding hospitalization was even worse then. So then by the end of our sophomore year, I decided to move back in with my parents. that was a safe place for us, but we recall it feeling like a quite the low point because we were leaving good friends behind. And we also felt we were defeating ourselves by not being able to live on our own.
Thank you so much for sharing that, Polly. You know, there's so much to unpack there, but I two things stood out to me. First is that, you know, when you have a predisposition to psychosis, typical college experiences like what you just described, going out, having fun, you know, not paying as much attention to your grades can just have such disastrous consequences without adequate intervention. And the second thing is like the lack of education and awareness about psychosis. Like, I wonder how different things would have been if you were able to articulate what you were going through, or if your friends could have helped you because they knew what was going on, or the school intervened. And again, these are places where like the system is a little bit broken. But I know after you went home, things turned around. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, so shortly after going back, moving in with our folks, we started seeing a psychiatrist who was wonderful at talk therapy. That was exactly what we wanted. I mean, we love to sing. We've always been a very verbal person. So this was our first therapist, recommended by a close family member. And they had a lot of patience. They were an excellent listener. They were very kind. They would use a lot of physical expression, both when they were talking and listening. So that helped immediately for us. That was huge. We felt heard for the first time, really, like a kindred spirit. And they established trust with us early on, just through casual conversation. It was professional. There were boundaries set. They would tell us tales from their own life sometimes, but it was brief and appropriate. So just building that trust, we don't recall them prescribing anything to us. They did eventually hand us a prescription for some pharmaceutical, but that wasn't until like our third or fourth session. So it was almost like more of a suggestion from a good friend. And so that, again, just feeling heard, that amount of trust that they very carefully built with us by listening to us was huge. And that's just what we needed at that time. So we also, after that therapy and having a little bit of the being on the medication briefly, we tried some group therapy, like going to some public groups. And that was good, but we were still mostly on our own. We didn't have a lot of other people, no friends with us that could do that with us. But through all that treatment, within a year, after a couple of other jobs, we finally landed like our dream job. We were selling computer software and video games at the mall. That's ever since I was 5 years old, watching Space Invaders and Pong, like this is the future. And so that was a dream job, and that was huge for us. Made a lot of good friends, longtime friends there. And another few years after that, we had children, and they are awesome to this day. Huge part of our life. We're very grateful for that.
I love that story, Polly. Thank you. Because it shows, among other things, that the extent to which having good quality treatment can just completely turn things around. I also think you spoke to the importance of the trust and relationship with your mental health providers. It sounds like your provider took a little while to bring up medication, but not too long by the third session. But by then, you'd kind of developed a relationship with her. And so you tried something, even though it was very novel. I know that.
Sorry to interrupt, but we weren't in any danger of self-harm at the time either. So it was very appropriate for our situation. So,
I'm so glad to hear that. You know, and I know since then, Polly, you've had a couple more decades of experience with the mental health system. So just zooming out a little bit, what are a couple of the systemic challenges that you've experienced that have affected your mental health?
Well, so we can speak on like diagnosis and misdiagnosis. This is actually something that we've been thinking a lot of even recently, and how it ties in with feeling rushed through the system sometimes, mostly from our past. So in a couple different ways. So like misdiagnosis and being rushed through the system. First of all, rushed evaluations. We think rushed evaluations can most definitely lead to misdiagnosis easily. However, that in turn can lead like to compound a person's negative experiences if further evaluations in the future are rushed. So it's kind of like a vicious cycle. So someone's rebuilding their life and the foundation of that is based on like bad data, that the future of their life's going to be skewed. And so then also, I don't want to say support folks, discussing reevaluation with us did happen, But again, it was like almost rushed or too clinical. It just wasn't that kind of more casual, friendly conversation. And again, sometimes that's understandable. There's nothing wrong with that. But perhaps if we'd been asked for more feedback or confirmation before taking a new medicine or something like that, maybe that would have had better results. So again, feeling heard, having being paid attention to individually. And just as important, another story that we have that sticks with us is we had inpatient therapy three times. The first two times with the same facility. And when we went back a third time, we were told, well, you were just here recently. It was something like, you know, maybe you're using the system too much or whatever. But the revolving door thing we hear a lot about for us was more like it was closed. So we had to find a third place. And then at that third place, we were reevaluated. So our suggestion could be like, maybe the reevaluations are fine, but if it's happening between different facilities or different types of care, pay attention to the individual.
Yeah, that's such an important thing, because I think what you're speaking to is what is one of the major issues with our care system, like that people often do get rushed through. Unstructured diagnostic methods are more common than structured ones, which are the gold standard in making a diagnosis, which affects the sort of medication you take and the side effects you have. And, you know, your story about, you know, going to that inpatient hospital and having that door closed to you speaks to how so often it's people can only get care when they're in crisis rather than kind of having preventative and ongoing care. It sounds to me like you were like, hey, I kind of know where I'm headed and I know what I need to do to stop it. But they weren't able to give you that. Now, Polly, just to start to wrap up, what are a couple of the systemic changes that you would like to see happen in the near future?
Yes, I was trying to actually make it more positive before, but this is so based on a lot of that, just training, a public discourse, equipping the public, professionals, of course, and I think the professional system is getting better at this, especially very recently, of course, but the general public. So when people start to have like a psychotic episode, even a stranger in public, some places have these like booths set up, which are wonderful to help people at least get information, but kind of like, defibrillators in public, right? Can we have something like that? It doesn't have to be a physical device, but educating the public on simple steps to take in case someone starts to have a breakdown. It needs to be done in a way so that everyone is safe, comfortable, their boundaries are being respected, of course, but we more serious effort on that front. And we've seen it start. That would be a wonderful place to focus. And I'd just like to say that, again, having a reliable care partner for staying with someone's treatment, whatever that treatment might be, because sometimes that treatment might need to change day to day. That's also very crucial.
Yeah, I agree so much with both of those, Polly, both the suggestion of psychoeducation and having like a treatment team that is consistent and is listening to you. We do know that there is so much stigma and misunderstanding around what psychosis is, partly due to like the way the media covers it. And I think we can do a lot better in terms of like what people associate with the word schizophrenia or psychosis, and helping them realize like there's a lot we can do to help. Polly, before we wrap up, is there anything else you would like to say?
Yes, actually, because the way that we think, like how we like to do liminal story crafting, that's mm-hmm. because seeing the connections between so many things that might seem disparate. So basically, to sum up a lot of what I talked about today, it's just that like we're aware, even just like preparing for this webinar, Arun, mm-hmm. how much the dialogue has changed over time. And that's important. There, like you pointed out, still needs to be a lot of change. But when we think about how it was in the early 90s compared to now, it actually helps us even deal with some of the memories that we have. So again, educating the public, talking about it, and that is very important to slow down, give people patience, silence, listening, and if one can safely, give them some of your time.
Yeah, what a different and wonderful system of care it would be if it were based on those values. Polly, thank you so much for your time. And for sharing your experience. You're here doing some of this education we speak of, and I really appreciate it. I am going to hand it back over to Sarah. Thank you, everyone, for listening.
Sarah, I think you're muted.
Dear, can you hear me now?
Yeah, so great. If you could perhaps start over.
Try again. I am so sorry about that.
You sound great.
I was just saying thank you to Arun and to Polly for their incredibly informative remarks, and we'll be seeing you later for the Q&A. So with that, I'm going to introduce our three more expert panelists. We're thrilled today to have with us Dr. Russell Margolis. He is professor of psychiatry and neurology in the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences of the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine in Baltimore, Maryland. Dr. Margolis received his undergraduate degree from Princeton and his MD from the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine and his residency training in psychiatry at Johns Hopkins Hospital. And I can hear someone talking here, so I don't know if someone needs to mute their mic. And then following Dr. Margolis's presentation, we will hear from Holly Kresa. Holly is the CEO and Managing Director of Blue Persimmon Group, a strategic advisory firm founded in 2019 that works with nonprofit advocacy and life sciences companies. Holly serves as the Secretary of the Board of Directors of the Schizophrenia and Psychosis Action Alliance and as an advisor for various nonprofit and academic organizations, committees, and consortia. She has spent her career working to improve the lives of people living with chronic health conditions, and we're so thrilled that she will be here to help explain some of the societal and economic and human costs of not addressing schizophrenia and psychosis. And then finally, we'll hear from Dr. Catherine or Katie Coe. Dr. Coe is a practicing psychiatrist at the Boston Healthcare for the Homeless Program and Massachusetts General Hospital. She's also an assistant professor of psychiatry at Harvard Medical School and is a member of the street team at the Boston Healthcare for the Homeless Program. Dr. Coe focuses her clinical care on homeless patients who live on the street through a combination of street outreach, clinic sessions, and home visits for patients recently or unstably housed. So those introductions do not nearly do justice to all of the incredible credentials of our panelists today. But in the interest of giving them the mic, I'm now going to turn it over to Russ.
Hello, everybody. I'm trying to, there we go. There we go. I hope everybody can hear me okay. I'm Russ Margolis from Johns Hopkins, where I'm the clinical director of the Johns Hopkins Schizophrenia Center. Next slide, please. Yep, there we are. There's Johns Hopkins. Next slide. So I want to reiterate something that Arun said in her very excellent introduction, that schizophrenia is a brain disease. And that's going to be the focus of my part of this seminar, for which I'm very grateful that I was invited to participate in. So there's a lot of evidence now, overwhelming evidence, that schizophrenia is a brain disease. This did not used to be the case. There were a variety of theories, many of which were blaming either the individuals with schizophrenia or their parents or those around them. And those, I think, have largely been laid to rest on a series of evidence. One that Arun already mentioned is genetic. There's been evidence for decades that schizophrenia tends to run in families, though not cleanly, and often people don't have family members with schizophrenia who then develop it themselves. But now with advanced genetic techniques, there is clear evidence that some genes, like those pointed out in this particular plot, that are very rare, if mutated, have increased the likelihood that a person develops schizophrenia greatly. And on the other hand, there's a large number of genetic factors which contribute very slightly to the risk of schizophrenia. And so somebody with schizophrenia typically has some combination of minor variants, genetic variants that add up, or rare variants. But again, providing compelling evidence for the fact that this is a brain disease. Neuroimaging, which really came to the forefront by the, say, mid-1980s, has also provided convincing evidence that the brains of individuals with schizophrenia are different than individuals without. Most classic are some twin studies, where in this case, you can see that there's a big difference in this fluid-filled space, the dark space, on the right-hand image of the twin with schizophrenia compared to their twin without schizophrenia. And there's a variety of other imaging findings that similarly show a difference in the brain. And another bit of evidence has emerged from the neuroanatomic study of postmortem brains of people with schizophrenia compared to those without schizophrenia. This is a particular example where these little dots, which are the little spines that are called on the sprouts from neurons, brain cells, are much more numerous in individuals without schizophrenia than on individuals with schizophrenia, suggesting a difference in how brain cells are connected to each other. Three really important caveats about this idea of schizophrenia as a brain disease. One is that at this point in time, the brain changes are too variable to use as a diagnostic tool in any one individual. Second, schizophrenia has a lot of subtypes that are only just beginning to emerge, and probably different subtypes will have different types of neurobiology. And third, underlying all of this is, regardless of whether we think of schizophrenia as a disease, it is a disease that affects a person. Each person is unique, and each person brings to the table their own sources of resilience and vulnerability. Next slide, please. So schizophrenia treatments can very broadly be divided into two types. The first are non-pharmacologic treatments, which I will not spend much time on here, but certainly deserve their own series of seminars. There's a variety of individualized, supportive, educational, and psychotherapeutic measures that can be helpful. These efforts are generally most effective in conjunction and coordinated with medicines. And I view it as the goal of treating the person with the illness. On the other hand, there are a lot of pharmaceutical agents available for treatment of schizophrenia, generally grouped together as antipsychotics, sort of a tautology based on how you call agents that are helpful with people with schizophrenia. Well, you just call them agents that are helpful for treating people with schizophrenia. These medicines tend to have somewhat different but overlapping properties. And now there's a large number of them available in the United States. The interesting thing is they all tend, at least the ones available on the market as of now, to work on the dopamine type 2 receptor, one of many receptors on neurons in the brain. And the difference is how they do that and the other receptor types that they affect. Next slide. There are a number of challenges to the treatments of schizophrenia, and here I'm going to focus again primarily on the medicine part of treatment. One, and this was alluded to by both Arun and Polly already, is finding the individuals who are in need to begin with, making sure that they have access to treatment, and then establishing the correct diagnosis. We found in some of our own work that a number of people, perhaps up to half in our study, that were thought to have schizophrenia did not. And the same thing is true the other way around, that individuals who do have schizophrenia may be misdiagnosed. And if there's a misdiagnosis, as Polly was alluding to, it sets people off on the wrong course, essentially bad data that's then used to make critical decisions. Second challenge, the benefits of the medicines are incomplete. Yes, the medicines help many people, but the effect on the symptoms of schizophrenia is far from complete. This graph is just shows a bunch of the available drugs and how effective they are. Zero would be no effect. One would be a pretty good effect. Most medicines are in the mild to moderate effectiveness range, with the particular exception of a medicine called clozapine, which we'll come back to. However, the effectiveness of medicine is most prominently for what are called the positive symptoms, the ones that Arun mentioned, that are often grouped together as psychosis, hallucinations, delusions, and disorders of thinking and behavior. They do not work very well for the other parts of schizophrenia, the negative symptoms, the lack of initiative, energy, motivation that is an issue for many individuals with schizophrenia, and some of the cognitive deficits that individuals with schizophrenia face. Medicines are not very helpful with those things. A third challenge is that there are individuals who don't respond at all to any of the available antipsychotics. Essentially, 70% of people with schizophrenia will get at least moderately better with a standard antipsychotic agent. An additional 15% will only respond to the special agent clozapine, and 15% won't respond to any agent whatsoever. Next slide. Challenges with medicines continue. The fourth is a number of side effects that range from being a nuisance to being life-threatening. Most commonly are neurologic side effects of abnormal movements or metabolic side effects such as weight gain or developing diabetes. A fifth challenge is the low adherence to medicine recommendations by individuals with schizophrenia. In part, this is common to individuals with any chronic illness, but there are specific factors in schizophrenia that increase the challenge, including an aspect of the illness where individuals often do not recognize that they're ill, the stigma individuals face, factors about side effects and avoiding side effects, and some of the issues of availability. Next slide. Other challenges. I guess this would be number five. There is underuse of long-acting injectable antipsychotic medicines, which are available to be used once every 2 weeks to once every 6 months, depending on the agent. This has been demonstrated to improve adherence, and not so well known is that it can decrease the tension that individuals with schizophrenia often experience with those involved in their care. Did you take your medicine? Please take your medicine, etc. Use of long-acting injectable medicines can take that off the table. Next issue is clozapine. This may work when other medicines fail. There seems to be some specific protection of this medicine against suicide. It can work more effectively even when other medicines are partly effective, but it's underused in part because there are a number of side effects that both clinicians and individuals with schizophrenia tend to avoid. And also there are very rigorous FDA mandated safety measures that are a major deterrent for both clinicians and individuals with schizophrenia, as well as even pharmacies. Next challenge, and this is a kind of a bigger picture idea, is that it's very difficult to develop new treatments when the biology of the disease is not understood. All currently available antipsychotic medicines were originally discovered either by accident or because they had properties that were similar to already existing antipsychotics. Pharmaceutical companies have largely been reluctant to invest in recent years into developing new treatments because of the lack of new biochemical targets for drugs. There is some good news on that front, that there are a few medicines with different mechanisms of actions that are beginning to work their way through the pipeline. Next slide. The future I would call one of bio-optimism and bio-advocacy. Obviously, there needs to be improved access to care, which means advocacy of funding for comprehensive treatment beyond the first few years of illness, which has recently gained some support. Advocacy for outreach into vulnerable populations, which Dr. Koh will address. And a simple but very powerful change, since our system is at least partially capitalistic in nature, is simply increasing the RVUs for providing psychiatric care, essentially paying practitioners better is likely to greatly incentivize practitioners to provide the care and make it much easier for individuals with illness to obtain care. Improved use of existing medicines is quickly possible, involves on the one hand clinician education about the value of long-acting injectables and clozapine, and on the other hand, work towards easing FDA restrictions on clozapine, the so-called risk evaluation and mitigation strategy, or REMS system, which should be done carefully in mind of the available evidence, but in ways that will facilitate the use of this very valuable drug, clozapine. Next, again, a big picture issue is taking advantage of the tremendous advantage in genetics and neuroscience to discover new treatments, the potential of detecting new pathways to target with new medicines. This involves advocacy of continued support for bottom-up disease-oriented research, starting with the cause of the illness and figuring out how that affects biochemical pathways and figuring out ways to interrupt those pathways. Similarly, pushing forward the discovery of biomarkers measurable biological features of schizophrenia with the potential to improve the diagnosis and early detection of disease by relying on measures that may be more precise than those that now are really clinical judgments. The potential to define subtypes of schizophrenia to facilitate what is called precision medicine, to target treatments or trials of medicines to particular subgroups of people and be more precise. The potential to find new clues into the neurobiology of disease and potential treatments, and the potential to make clinical trials of new treatments more precise and less expensive by targeting precise groups of individuals. Overall, I'd conclude with the imperative need to fund service delivery, service-oriented research, that is, how to best provide care, and the genetic neurobiology research that will underlie the future of developing new treatments. These sometimes are pitted against each other, but in fact, advocacy needs to be on behalf of all of them. And with that, I'll turn matters back over to our moderator.
Great. Russ, thank you so much. That was an incredible, incredible overview. And there's already lots of questions coming in, but to get us to our Q&A, I'm gonna go ahead and turn it over to Holly Kresa, and we'll get to some of those clinical questions in our Q&A. Thanks again for your overview there.
Thank you, Sarah. And thank you, Russ. Well, and thank you everyone for taking time today to learn how we can work together towards improved outcomes for individuals living with schizophrenia, their families, and society overall. Over the next few minutes, I'll take a little time to show you what the lived experience, so eloquently and bravely described by Polly, translates to at a societal level. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Schizophrenia affects approximately 1% of the world's population, typically emerging during late adolescence and early adulthood. Put this into context, that means one in every 100 kids will be diagnosed with schizophrenia as they begin the critical period when people start their careers, pursue education, and build relationships. To determine the full impacts of schizophrenia on society and to better measure progress towards improved outcomes, it's critical to count all of those that are affected across every setting. This is challenging due to the nature of the disease, diagnosis difficulty, barriers in our current system that often lead to individuals living outside of traditional households, so it's difficult to count them through our normal methods for determining the prevalence of a disease. Various studies have estimated how people are affected with wide variations. The lowest estimates come from research conducted primarily in those responding to household surveys, likely missing a large portion of those that are affected. To fully understand the impact on society, we must ensure we account for all those that are affected by schizophrenia, no matter the setting. Next slide, please. The impacts of schizophrenia are multifaceted, exceeding hundreds of billions of dollars annually in the United States. Cost estimates include direct costs like medical expenses, hospitalization, medication therapy, long-term care, and support services such as housing and disability support. Indirect costs include impacts from the high unemployment rates among individuals with schizophrenia and reduced productivity in many that are employed. Due to the complex and debilitating nature of this disorder, without access to care and collaboration across support system stakeholders, many people with schizophrenia face a heightened risk of living on the streets, often victims of crimes, or ending up in correctional facilities instead of being supported where the support should be provided within our healthcare system. Finally, millions of family members and friends of individuals with schizophrenia fill the gaps that are in our system as it stands now, willingly doing anything to help by providing unpaid care and financial support, often significantly impacting their own work, educational choices, and personal lives. To solve for all these impacts, billions of dollars are also spent each year in government and private funding for countless programs, critical research, and continuous training. All of these inputs or impacts are costs that need to be accounted for. Next slide, please. When including all available information as we know it today, recent estimates suggests that the societal cost of schizophrenia in the United States are over $280 billion each year in excess specific to this population. One study estimated $62 billion in direct costs, primarily covering healthcare and supportive housing. In that same study, staggering indirect costs encompassing lost productivity, particularly due to unemployment and the impacts of caregivers, was seen. The strain on the healthcare system is immense, with insufficient access to quality care leading to delays in diagnosis, inadequate treatment, and limited follow-up care. These factors likely result in the shocking $14.5 billion we spend each year on incarceration of individuals living with schizophrenia. Lost opportunity costs and caregiver impacts drive over $219 billion in indirect costs each year as well. What this means at an individual level is that each year, an additional $90,000 per individual is spent to support this population, which leads to staggering lifetime costs for this condition, considering how young individuals are when they are diagnosed and when you follow them throughout their life. We know that these are likely underestimates as well. Many inputs were not available to include in these studies, such as costs for those affected under the age of 18, impacts of reduced career attainment and wages for caregivers, counseling or case management expenses, personal legal fees, and other support program costs. It's critical to obtain current and complete data from all sources and settings to measure and monitor the effectiveness of programs and funding targeted to help improve outcomes. Next slide, please. One major cost driver that's worth spending a little extra time on is how important it is to understand what informal care partners do to support their loved ones. Recent research suggests informal caregivers spend about 40 hours per week providing ongoing support, assistance with daily activities, and financial aid while balancing their own personal and professional responsibilities. Informal caregivers spend almost $2,000 each month to support everyday needs of their loved one, including mental health treatment costs, transportation, and housing services. In addition, families spend up to $4,000 each year on average on major events that affect individuals living with schizophrenia. The toll can be significant as care partners grapple with the challenges of caregiving, navigating complex healthcare and legal systems, and coping with the stigma associated with mental illness. Caregivers report frequent impacts on work, education, personal and other humanistic impacts of providing support, including lost wages, passing on social family gatherings, avoiding vacations, and altering personal goals. Next slide. It's important to note that there are many things we can do to change this cost trajectory and to improve outcomes at an individual and a societal level. We need to target funding and support in the right places to address access to quality healthcare. The current U.S. system faces challenges like long waiting lists, limited availability of specialized and trained professionals. Timely and barrier-free care is critical to ensure positive outcomes for individuals with schizophrenia. To accomplish this, a multidisciplinary approach involving psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, and occupational therapists is essential to ensure comprehensive treatment. In creating mental health services and primary care and expanding specialized community centers can improve outcomes and reduce costs. One study suggests up to 17% each year or $68 billion in estimated savings. Community-based support services are also crucial. Supported employment programs, affordable housing initiatives, and peer support networks help individuals maintain employment, secure housing, and build relationships, reducing reliance on emergency services and long-term care. Another step requires the removal of unexpected restrictions to care that may be well-intentioned, but have adverse impacts on those living with schizophrenia. For example, amending the current IMD exclusion is a critical step to enabling full care integration. In its current form, this exclusion limits the availability of inpatient psychiatric services, leading to increased emergency room visits, homelessness, and criminal justice involvement, placing a significant financial burden on states and local communities. Investing in mental health services and research is also vital. For example, research providing the current and complete estimate of those impacted and their associated costs is crucial to directing funding and assessing the progress of various programs and initiatives. By prioritizing brain health, investing in research, and creating supportive environments, we can alleviate the impact of schizophrenia, improve lives, and build a more inclusive society. Next slide. The societal costs of schizophrenia in the United States are substantial and include economic burdens, social challenges, and stigma. We need a multifaceted approach, including early intervention, multidisciplinary care, increased funding and access to services, community-based support programs, medication adherence, combating stigma, and promoting understanding. These changes can transform care and outcomes to create a more inclusive society where all individuals with schizophrenia can lead fulfilling lives and contribute to our communities. I'll now turn things over back to the moderator and Dr. Ko to describe various opportunities for improved outcomes. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Holly. And so glad to now turn it over to Dr. Katie Ko. Katie, welcome.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Sarah. And my video does not seem to be cooperating today, so I very much apologize for that, but I will still do my best to slides in a clear and compelling way. I'm very glad that you can see them. And thank you so much to my co-presenters for your fantastic and thoughtful presentations. I'm really delighted to be here today. Next slide, please. So as a street psychiatrist, I focus my clinical and research efforts on people with severe mental illness who live on the street. And my presentation will focus on what happens when we don't create systems that adequately care for people with psychotic illness and what we can do to remedy that. Next slide, please. So how have we as a society accepted this as normal? A man in the midst of suffering sleeping on concrete, while a man in business clothes hurries by like many city dwellers, seemingly anesthetized to stepping around the body of a fellow human being living on the street. This has never been and never should be normal. And in fact, for most of human history, it has not been. It was not until the mid-1900s, through a combination of closure of state hospitals, known as deinstitutionalization, in conjunction with federal defunding of community-based care and a reduction in affordable housing and generic social services, that people with severe mental illness were often left without anywhere to go, and seeing people living on the street became commonplace. As Arun mentioned, studies suggest that up to one-third of the homeless population is thought to have a severe mental illness, and this is one of the worst possible outcomes, what happens when we don't create systems that care for people with psychotic illness, leading to abominable rates of abuse, incarceration, discrimination, suicide, chronic disease, and premature death. This is intolerable, but also preventable. So what can be done? I firmly believe that it is not mental illness itself that leads to homelessness, but lack of systems of care for people with mental illness that leads people to these adverse outcomes. Next, please. We have solutions that work, but what we need is political will to invest in and prioritize them. These solutions include a continuum of prevention, community-based, and facility-based care, and it is not one solution, but a multi-sector, comprehensive approach throughout the lifespan that is needed to truly give these individuals the life they desire and deserve. First, prevention must be a key pillar, including early detection of these illnesses. Studies show that there is a concept called the duration of untreated psychosis, and the shorter the duration, the better the outcomes. Access to affordable housing and supported employment, which is when people with mental illness are assisted in both obtaining and maintaining employment, give people purpose, meaning, and dignity. And as others have alluded to, rigorous national research from the standpoint of biomedical, genetic prevalence, and financial implications of schizophrenia must be a priority to inform intervention and policy. Community-based care must be central to this continuum. Assertive community treatment is a form of treatment that focuses on a group of multidisciplinary professionals providing intensive services to people with severe mental illness, and multiple randomized controlled trials in multiple countries have shown that it reduces length of hospitalization and improves functional outcomes. Therapy, medication, and psychoeducation are all key pieces of the treatment, including cognitive behavioral therapy, cognitive rehabilitation, and family therapy. And then mental health outreach. These proactive models are essential for those whom the system has failed. And I will be speaking more about that in depth. And then finally, we need to redesign our inpatient facilities to provide high quality and facility-based care. I think the focus should certainly be on minimizing time in facilities whenever possible, but I also think it's important to recognize that if done correctly, hospitalizations at the right time can be transformative for people. And we need to focus on building compassionate inpatient facilities, which includes a focus on purpose and community, empowering staff and reducing burnout to create a culture of healing. And finally, recognizing that compassionate inpatient facilities and community-based care are both key components and not mutual replacements in an effective continuum of care. Click next, please. And what gives me hope, and one of the reasons why I think this conference is so timely and important, is that recently there has been political will to invest in solutions for people with severe mental illness, with a particular focus on those living in poverty and on the street. So, for instance, in the bottom left-hand corner, you'll see Mayor Eric Adams of New York City. Many of you may have heard he released a controversial plan to lower the threshold for involuntary hospitalization for people with severe mental illness living on the street. Governor Gavin Newsom of California on the right created the CARES Act, which leverages the court system to bring people with severe mental illness and substance use disorders into care. Click next, please. And also at the state level, Governor Kathy Hochul of New York announced a more than $1 billion comprehensive plan integrating community and hospital-based care, devoting the majority of this funding to supportive housing, assertive community treatment, and other pillars of community-based care. And we could certainly debate each of these proposals on ethical and practical grounds. While I don't think all of it is the most effective approach, I do think that there are some elements, like particularly Governor Hochul's plan to focus on community-based care, that I think show great promise. And I think this momentum, more importantly, shows that there is increasing policy attention to this topic and presents us with an important opportunity to reimagine and advocate for this optimal continuum of care for people experiencing severe mental illness. My colleague and I wrote a viewpoint in JAMA just last month that outlines our vision for this for those who are interested. And so I'm going to focus the rest of the time, if you can click next, please, on mental health outreach and street psychiatry, which is the day-to-day work that I do to show the power of this model to create good outcomes for those in need. Next slide, please. So what are these mental health outreach models and what do they look like? The purpose and premise of these models are to proactively bring care to people who would likely not receive it otherwise. Many individuals with severe mental illness have understandably had negative and difficult experiences with a healthcare system, as Polly has alluded to. And also another big challenge, as we know with these illnesses, is that oftentimes people lack insight into what they're experiencing. And so oftentimes so much trust building and connection and human relationship are needed before one can even address the clinical care. So programs like Boston Healthcare for the Homeless Program, which I'm tremendously fortunate to work for, does just this. We go out on the street, under bridges and alleyways and sidewalks, try and meet people where they are and build trusting relationships and get people to a point where they're willing to engage with us, and we walk with them on their journeys until we can get there. My wonderful mentor in this work, Dr. Eileen Riley, pictured in the bottom right, has this beautiful saying: she'll meet a patient, they'll decline to engage, and she'll think, okay, they're on the five-year plan. And I just think that's such a beautiful and longitudinal perspective, and so different than the way I was trained in my residency program to make these 20 or 30 minute assessments in the emergency room about a person and figure out their whole life story and treatment. But so much of this work is about the longitudinal nature of people's lives and their hopes and dreams, and really seeking to understand that in order to ultimately give them the best care possible. Boston Healthcare for the Homeless Program is a federally qualified health center and funded through a combination of federal grants, clinical revenue from insurance, and philanthropy. And there's now over 200 programs such as this this throughout the country. Ideally, this involves interdisciplinary teams and providing this care together. So I go out arm in arm with someone else from my team, a case manager, a nurse, recovery coach, various people on my team will always go out in pairs so we can coordinate and facilitate care in the moment. Next slide, please. So just to give you a little more idea of what this looks like on the ground, in the upper left-hand corner, you'll see my fantastic colleague, our recovery coach, talking to a person we met in an encampment. He experienced severe mental illness and substance use disorders himself and has completely rebuilt his life, one of the most remarkable human beings I've ever met. And I believe so deeply in the value of peer specialists and providing effective care. He's able to connect with patients in a way that myself, without that lived experience, never could. You'll see one of our founding physicians, Dr. Jim O'Connell, talking with our beloved patient in the upper right-hand corner. You notice he's sitting down with her. We really try and be at or ideally below eye contact with patients as a way to provide trauma-informed and non-hierarchical care. You'll see myself with my nurse practitioner colleague and case manager colleague in the bottom left-hand corner. You can see him holding socks. We tend to give out socks and snacks and supplies as engagement tools as a way of building trust with folks, developing those relationships over time. And then finally, you'll see my nurse practitioner colleague giving out a COVID vaccine to a person on the street. But we were very successful in giving out over about 1,000 vaccines over the past couple years, including to people with severe mental illness, and I don't think that would have been possible had we not established those pre-existing trusting relationships. Next slide, please. So just to end on a story of hope, I will give you guys just a second to look at this slide. I don't know if anyone notices anything interesting. I'm sure there's a number of interesting things we could comment on, but this is underneath the Zakim Bridge, a major bridge in Boston. And if you zoom a little bit closer, next slide, please, you'll actually notice something quite interesting. I don't know if anyone sees it now, but one more click. There's actually a tent in this very remote corner underneath the bridge and this body of water. And so my colleague was biking to work one day and noticed this tent, and really shows the power of perceptiveness and street outreach and street psychiatry. We ended up outreaching to this woman, discovered that she had been living there for 7 years, had not been connected to care. And this woman is absolutely remarkable. She found out about our clinic and our services on a Monday and came into our walk-in clinic held at Mass General Hospital on a Thursday. She told me she had been in 150 foster homes throughout her life, had experienced unimaginable trauma, which so many of these individuals unfortunately face, and still had this beautiful, kind, resilient spirit about her. She was motivated to get treatment. She had a psychotic illness. We started her on an antipsychotic, and I am happy to say she has now been housed for a year and a half. She's working 40 hours a week at a gas station. She's looking to go back to school, and she's engaged to be married. And I don't want to, though the story gives me a tremendous hope, I also don't want to create the impression that, you know, this is the outcome for everyone, or that this is it's that easy. I think this is a particularly wonderful and inspiring story, but I also think that this story represents the outcome we absolutely should be striving for everyone, why we should never give up hope, and why this should never be considered as normal. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Katie, and thank you so much to everybody on the panel. I want to invite all of our experts back onto camera, or to keep your sound on, Katie, for some Q&A. We have about 20 minutes, and there are lots of audience questions here, so really appreciate everybody's incredible presentations. I want to just start off with a question actually about the role of trust, because we've had a few audience questions come in, and some of the questions have to do with what do you do when someone refuses treatment? How does that factor in? I wonder, you know, Polly, as my kind of co-moderator here for this Q&A section. If there's anything that you would want to say about trust, you spoke so eloquently about that need to have that trusted provider. Are there things that folks in the policy community can do to help facilitate that?
Well, I would say that as I touched on briefly, it is establishing a casual type of relationship while still listening to the person that you're trying to provide care for to get to know their boundaries first and foremost. And that's especially true, and that language exists now all throughout our societies. So I think that was key for me and still seems to resonate with a lot of people. And I know that that is something that that Katie touched on, is that like with the socks and everything, having appropriate outreach, that's that first step is crucial.
Great, thank you. And Katie, you shared, Katie and Holly and Russ as well, kind of shared some different policy ideas or solutions to help address some of these system-wide challenges for populations experiencing homelessness, to expand community-based care, to accelerate biomedical innovation. I'm just wondering if each of you could kind of speak to, like one or two things that you think you'll be following over the next 12 to 18 months that would be particularly important for policymakers to pay attention to. And Holly, why don't we start with you?
Sure, thanks. You know, I think the main evidence really has to do with supporting radical collaboration across the system. And really anything, as I tell people, anything that you see that could be a barrier to care in policy that's in front of you is just critical to do what you can to remove that barrier. There's many different opportunities that show up on a daily basis. But this is one of those situations where the only people that really understand what's needed are the individual living with the condition and their care providers. And we need to do everything we can to free things up. Telehealth used appropriately has been very, very useful, as well as many other initiatives like that that enable an integration of care.
Great, I second that from personal experience. Yep.
Fantastic. And Katie, we can hear you. Tell your work certainly exemplifies this idea of radical collaboration. Are there common threads in these policy proposals that you think are going to be particularly effective?
Yes, thank you so much, Sarah. And I couldn't agree more with what Polly and Holly have already highlighted. I think when creating policy, centering the human being is essential. Numbers and data are critically important, but I think it's also crucial that policymakers and people in power are interacting with people living with these illnesses to create the most effective and compassionate policies. I'll share, I'm someone who comes from a privileged background. I grew up, in a nice suburb of Massachusetts. I had two wonderful physician parents, and I had never interacted with somebody who was homeless or with severe mental illness until I went to college. And I had so many misconceptions about these individuals that I'm ashamed to think about now. But after getting to know them personally, I'm just kind of enraptured by their kindness and courage and resilience and ability to connect as well. I think some people think, these people are going to be deranged or difficult to interact with, but you really see that they are just human beings like you and me who happen to have a different set of circumstances and deck of cards dealt to them in life. And so I think it's critically important that policymakers have these conversations and interactions with people who are experiencing the policies that they're trying to experiencing the illness. These policies are designed to help. And also, I couldn't agree more with Holly that, a multi-sector comprehensive approach to the lifespan is what is critically needed. And our team, we really take this interdisciplinary approach. And oftentimes, people will first have a relationship with the case manager because that's what their most pressing needs are around. And that relationship with the case manager is what allows them to then trust me. If I come recommended from our case manager and they say Dr. Coe's across the hall or she's out on outreach and me, they're much more willing to meet with me or talk with me than I think if I was someone who didn't come from a trusted source. So the intersector collaborations are so important from both a team and clinical perspective, and then zooming out from a policy perspective, thinking about the different sectors and across the lifespan.
That's so great. And Katie, I do have one follow-up on this before moving to sort of more the biomedical front. This comes from the audience. Someone asked that multiple speakers have spoken favorably about facility-based care, removing the IMD exclusion without purposely incentivizing community-based care over facility-based care. Are workforce shortages and pressure for cost savings prioritizing facilities over community-based care? And I just wonder if you have any thoughts on that before we move to the more biomedical policy space.
I think that is such an important point, and thank you very much for the audience members who raised that. I mean, I think a major problem in why we have such a community-based workforce shortage is lack of adequate financial reimbursement from insurers for this work, you know, and as a result, only 50% of psychiatrists take any insurance at all. And then when they do take insurance, it's much more likely to be commercial insurance rather than Medicaid or Medicare. And you can understand, too, from a psychiatrist perspective, you know, these well-meaning psychiatrists coming out of medical school with large debts are disincentivized from caring for this population, even if they have good intentions. So the financial incentives, the payment structure absolutely needs to change if we're going to make this work sustainable and make meaningful policy change.
Thank you. So, Paul, you recently participated in an FDA meeting, a Food and Drug Administration, on patient-centered drug development or patient-focused drug development. And I'm wondering, you know, why that was important to you. And then I'd love to ask for Russ to speak as his experience as a clinician innovator, why that's important.
Yeah, well, the patient-focused drug development, the name right off the bat is what attracted me to it. I mean, I was honored to be invited to participate in anything that was going to take a lot of this discussion even further on Capitol Hill and in other critical areas of the industry. And it, all the wonderful people I met there too, helped me in my journey. I mean, my journey is constantly evolving, especially because the public discourse is becoming healthier now. And it's happening more. And now that it's in the news so much more. And as was pointed out, people who have a lot of, for lack of a better term, pull in the political arena are stepping up and making big differences. And we have a long way to go. But again, just the name, patient focused. I was like, okay, where have I been? Because this is, that's huge right there.
That's huge. And, Russ, Dr. McGraw, if you could speak to that, and how do you think that's important in terms of the innovation? You know, you talked about needing more innovation in this space. Love to hear your thoughts on that.
Well, I think there's likely a good space for this going forward, because on the one hand, the advances in the biology of the disease allows schizophrenia and related disorders to be subgrouped. And that then becomes more individualized for patients on the one hand. So you can imagine a clinical trial rather than trying to work with a bunch of people with different disorders, fundamentally narrowing it down so that you have a smaller, cheaper, faster trial that's more specific to the folks who might benefit. That's sort of from the biomedical standpoint, from a patient oriented standpoint. And I think Polly and Holly both may be able to speak to this even further. The idea of patient involvement in selecting outcome measures, in selecting the trial design so that it is as least disruptive and most likely to yield real meaningful results rather than a statistical result that may not actually have practical meaning and the like, I think is of tremendous value in moving forward. So it's kind of a cross between recognition of individuals and what they can bring to the table and what the science can bring, and putting those two together to become more effective in speeding up the process of developing new treatments.
That's great. Thank you. And we had somewhat of a follow-on question from the audience. Someone wanted to know if you could describe current research into medications that may target different mechanisms, such as different genetic or brain functions. And so again, I know some of your research focuses on those subtypes. So if there's a high level that you could share about that for this broad audience, that would be great.
Well, there's one drug that's actually a mixture of a couple drugs that are designed to target what are called muscarinic receptors, dealing with the acetylcholine system rather than the dopaminergic system. And that has a decent chance of reaching market within a year or two. As an example, how radically different that will be, time will tell. So that's the near future. Over the longer haul, the idea is to take advantage of some new findings in genetics, for instance, to say, aha, this gene or set of genes is disrupted in people, some people with schizophrenia, and that means this particular pathway, this biochemical pathway, might be abnormal, and let's explore that and see if we can find new ways to target the pathway. So that's the longer term future.
Great, thank you. Arun, I haven't asked you a question in a little while. We've gotten a question from the audience about health disparities and health equity considerations. And our questioner notes that Black and Hispanic patients are significantly more likely than white patients to be diagnosed with schizophrenia, less likely with psychotic depression, experience worse psychosocial and clinical outcomes. Of course, that unfortunately tracks a lot of the data from across the health system. But what thoughts would you offer in terms of not only improving the system for all individuals experiencing schizophrenia, but for particularly trying to reduce those health disparities?
Thank you for that question, Sarah. So just to kind of give people an idea of the extent to which this is a problem, there's research where we combined like over 50 studies and over 2 million people, where we found that Black individuals are 2.4 times more likely to be diagnosed with schizophrenia than white people in the US. And this is like independent of like when the study was done. It's not getting smaller with time. It varies a little bit with geography, but not too much. And this is also the case with Latinx and Hispanic folks. And I just want to preface this by saying there is like no evidence at all for a genetic reason for this disparity. It is caused by the environment in various ways. And I'm going to just answer this very briefly, but it is essentially thought to be the result of interpersonal racism and the downstream effects of structural racism. So interpersonally, there's something called cultural mistrust, which is considered like a normative response to experiencing racism on a regular basis. So when we screen for things like paranoia, we ask questions about like, do you feel like sometimes people are out to get you? Do you feel like sometimes people are following you around? These experiences are actually part of the everyday reality of Black folks, regardless of whether they experience psychosis or not. And these sorts of experiences have been shown to be associated with higher rates of psychotic symptoms in the general population. And then if you think about things like the kind of constant threat of like police brutality and what that must do to somebody who has any sort of predisposition to psychosis, you start to get a picture of even if the underlying genetic predisposition is the same, all Black folks might have higher rates of schizophrenia. On the structural level, I'll give one example. We know that obstetric complications are a risk factor for developing schizophrenia. We also know that Black women are at especially high risk of obstetric complications for a variety of reasons, and their medical needs are often not met. And so it's a combination of those sorts of factors that kind of have this downstream effect on schizophrenia diagnoses. And then once they're diagnosed, Black folks tend to have higher rates of incarceration, homelessness, and hospitalizations and unemployment. And so this is really kind of in the same way that we need to kind of have equitable, or we need to kind of be able to change structure. We're talking here about systemic change. the same sort of change needs to happen in order to provide equitable care to Black folks. And what we are finding in general is, like, when they get the treatment that when they have access to treatment and they attend treatment, and they're not alienated from it, their trajectories of improvement match those of white folks. So it really is a matter of addressing racism and access to care.
Thank you so much. So we have a lot more questions from our audience, and I'm going to apologize in advance that we're not going to be able to get to all of them. I will say there are many people writing in with personal questions about friends or family or children and treatment options that are kind of specific clinical questions. So apologies that we can't get to all of those. But what I do want to ask of each of our panelists in the last 5 minutes or so that we have is there anything that you, from your vantage point, would like to say to the people who are across the country who are either struggling with the diagnosis or maybe on their way to recovery or, you know, living their best life? What would you like to say to the people who are living this day in and day out? And Katie, maybe we can start with you since you're on the mic there. Katie, how about we start with you?
Sure. I would just conclude by saying this conference and webinar has given me such a great deal of hope. And I think that fits with the message that we want to be sharing, and that this is a treatable illness in most cases with the right support and with the right structure, with the right investment. And so seminars like this is how we make progress, by coming together to share our interdisciplinary perspectives, and also by each of you in the audience coming to commit your time to learn and hopefully bring this knowledge forward to be able to work together to create policy and clinical change that really supports these individuals as they desire and deserve. So I would just say thank you to everyone who took their time, both my co-presenters in the audience, to be here today, because I really think that the only way that we can make change is if we work together with the passion and information and desire that everyone has shown today.
Thank you. Russell, how about you? We can't hear you.
I share the idea of hope. And I can be very specific. I think that there is both short-term reason for hope, even for those who are already engaged in treatment but finding it frustrating, that the nature of our treatments, both pharmacologic and non-pharmacologic, are improving all the time. And there's reason to be optimistic about that for the future. And so that there's reason to be optimistic if one has not yet found optimal treatment settings, that there is movement afoot to improve quality and access of care in general.
Thank you. Holly, how about yourself?
Sure, very simply, thank you for all your contributions. Thank you for everything you give us so that we can try and address the issues that are happening. But most importantly, we see you, we hear you. Please keep sharing. You count. Your experience counts, each and every one of them. Thank you very much for everything.
Thank you. Arun, and then we're going to give Polly the last word. So Arun, what do you think?
I just want to echo what everyone else said. There is so much reason for hope. And this to me is a problem that can be fixed and really change so many lives. So I will just add that I think enough cannot be said about the value of, like, kindness and seeing people and educating yourself and standing up and correcting misconceptions and myths about psychosis when they come up, which is on a very regular basis. And that's something I think everybody here can do. And I assume if you're here, you do care about it enough. So, I just think kindness and education can go a long way in changing these systems as well, in addition to all the actual policy changes that need to happen.
Great. Thank you. And so, Polly, before I give you the very, very last word, I want to thank our audience for coming. I want to remind you that a recording of this webinar will be made available on our website at allhealthpolicy.org, that you can find us on LinkedIn and other social media, and that if you have any further questions or ideas for future webinars, you can please note those in the survey that you will receive after this webinar. And so Polly, take us out. It's been such an honor to meet you, and I feel like I have a new friend out in Michigan. So thank you for being with us today. And what is your message to our audience today?
Well, also, I return all the love and thanks that I've felt here and the education just from getting to know you all. And yes, to everyone who showed up here, if you've been attending this webinar, this is incredible. I'd like to say, especially if you know people my age, but age really isn't appropriate, I think, in this discussion too. But so like our own personal philosophy and advocacy is patience, silence, listening, and slow down. Maybe, again, as I said before, if you can, give someone your time. It's a very precious resource, of course. And so the support community, we really need to assure people who are suffering that anything that they are feeling is valid and important, and that there are people who are here to listen to them. And so I recently picked this up, by the way, outside Seattle, Washington, and this is how I like to change the wording in songs. If anyone knows that, don't worry, be happy. So, you know.
That's great. And for those who maybe didn't catch the visual, that said, don't hurry, be happy. And I was that a sloth on there, a sloth animal? Yeah. I love that. That's amazing. Okay, so there you have it. The last word, patience, listen, slow down, don't hurry, be happy. Thank you all. Thank you to SNPAA for your partnership on this and to all of our wonderful supporters. And thank you to Holly, Arun, Russ, Katie, and to Polly Benjamin. Have a great afternoon, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.